welcome to this morning session. We are very happy to see that so many of you decided to be here and listening to us, where we'll be talking about social media and international development, communication for social change in the digital age. Thank you, Jacob. My name is Marie Brobeck, and I am product manager for Ørecomm, which is a cross-border Swedish and Danish research-driven center working with communication for development. Today we will give you some short presentation about communication for development. What is it all about? And we will also present one of our new project called Global Communication in the Öresund region, or just GOCOM. And the way it works here today is that we will have three different researchers and one social entrepreneur. They will give three shorter presentations. And after that, we will open the floor up for questions. And the first speaker we have here today is Lene Bull. And Lene Bull is an assistant professor from Roskilde University. And today she will talk about From Denmark with Love, establishing a national narrative of fællesskab or community, and which is an analysis of the annual campaign Danmarks Insamlingen. So welcome up, Lene. Thank you.
And I have to put this on five. Yes. Good morning, everybody. I'll just fiddle a little bit with the tech, ever so slightly. Yes, the title of my presentation is From Denmark with Love, and I am looking at a very small corner of a pretty large postdoc project, so you'll hopefully forgive me for not going into every detail of the material that I'm going to show you right now. What I am focusing on here is a reading of particular materials from the annual telethon here in Denmark, which is called Danmarks Indsamling. And I'm looking at how Danmarks Indsamling is functioning by creating a narrative of community, unity, or what we would in Danish call fællesskab. I am also going to have to ask you to forgive me because I have not translated the video clips that I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you a very short section of a trailer for the show, which was uploaded to Facebook. Serves two purposes of saving time and giving you what was available on Facebook. And I want you to pay attention to not so much the message, but the diversity of people that are participating in this short segment.
Det var min mor, der tjente penge til familien.
Det var min mor, der fik min bror i skole.
Så fødte hun mig.
Og døde under fødslen.
Så nu er der ikke nogen til at tjene penge.
Ingen til at sørge for, at vi får mad.
Alt for mange børn i verden lever et liv uden en mor. Vær med, når hele Danmark samler ind for at give børnene den støtte, de mangler. Danmarks Indsamling. Lørdag den 1. februar på DR1.
So, what I'm taking away from this is, first of all, the variety of different characters that are on display, both celebrities and so-called ordinary people from different walks of life, and also shown in their own social context, or that is at least what we are led to believe. This is also spread out over multiple media platforms. It is Danmarks Radio, the national broadcaster, which is organizing Danmarks Indsamling. And they're using both TV, radio, and online media very actively in the campaign. I'm just going to show you a small segment of the sort of multitude of different things that are going on in Danmarks Indsamling. And again, we have a very wide variety of people who participate actively in the collection. So you've got a national bake sale organized by home care workers. You've got the royal family, you've got the prime minister, rock bands, school children, local businesses, and you also have very large corporations that participate in the show. And these are all showcased across all the media platforms. I find this small Facebook update really illuminating in terms of the narrative that I am looking at. This is a Facebook update from Christian Friis-Bach, who's a politician who was at the time the Minister for Development. And it seems as if this is just a random snapshot from his phone that he has taken on the eve of the show in 2013, where he had been staffing phones in Roskilde Dome. And he is showcasing, first of all, in the text, the diversity of people who had phoned in money that he had talked to during the evening, and sort of showing off the many different social positions that these people occupy. But I find the picture itself quite interesting as well, because it is also a display of diversity and unity. You see different cultural personalities, and of course, most interesting, the young pop star Basim, who's cozying up to Pia Kjaergaard, who's a right-wing politician. So what I find quite interesting here is that there is a coming together of all of these characters in this one event which creates unity, and where we are led to imagine that we are all acting as one in unison, and thus becoming one. And what I think is interesting to look at is, what is it that brings this about? How is it that people are led into thinking that we are all working in unison as a social body? What is it that unites us, and what is it that enables this unity? And I'm going to show you just a very short and cut-off piece of a video from 2013, where the popular TV show X Factor was lead-in for Denmark's Indsamling. And thus, X Factor that year, that very day, had a Denmark's Indsamling theme and had a song written for the occasion. I'm just going to give you a short segment of the song.
Mine damer og herrer, her X Factors støttesang, En Verden.
Du har så meget kærlighed, siger du. Men hvem får al denne kærlighed? De får udvalgte. Eller har du kærlighed nok til hele verden?
Jeg ser, at verden bløder. Ser kontinenter gløder i haven. Og råd.
We can bear it.
then I have to cut it short in order not to run out of time. What I want to focus on here is this articulation of community, or in Danish, fællesskab. Because what is being articulated in the song is a double articulation of this fællesskab. On the one hand, we have an articulation of we who have, which is the national fællesskab, which is being called into being in this instance. And on the other hand, we have all those who cannot walk themselves, EI, the suffering other, which is the global fællesskab that is enabling the national fællesskab, in my reading. So this national unity in diversity narratives actually comes into being in relation with a distant suffering other. And that distant suffering other is placed in a global division of responsibilities where we who have are being called upon to act on this suffering other. However, what happens is, of course, that this suffering other must be able to bring together all these different social and political positions, and therefore is depicted as worthy and helpless. And what I find interesting is that in order to enable the diversity narrative of the Danish nation, there is a moral imperative to act. And the moral imperative is set outside of the national community. It is an affective and a loving relation with a constitutive other. So, yeah, this is my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lene. And now we will move over to Tobias Denskus, who is a senior lecturer in communication for development in Malmö, at Malmö University. And Tobias is
Well, good morning, everyone. I mean, I think I just wanted to take a minute to reflect on what we just heard from Lene, because I think her presentation, the contents very much reflects some of the intention and all the broader questions we are addressing. I mean, first of all, that we now are aware that representations of development are changing and they're becoming much more mainstream. I mean, a telethon like this has been going on before, but as Lena showed, it's taking place on multiple platforms and multiple times. There's a very different way of engagement. And that different form of public engagement obviously also calls for a different form of engagement from the researcher side. So the very fact that Lena is using this as her research, that she is analyzing video, that she is analyzing social media, is, if you know a little bit about research, it's actually kind of a big deal. So in that sense, for us as researchers to reach out and use social media data as data for research is one of the aspects of communication for development that we are interested in. And also the fact that we are actually standing here today at a social media week is, I think, something that is indicative of how some of the broader dynamics in research and communication for development, but also critical research, is changing. So when we look today at development work and some of the presentations, the popular presentations around development, you know, we are really faced with a multitude of new forms of engagement. We encounter philanthropists. We encounter new forms of engagement. Good old Bono telling us that poverty will be eradicated by 2030, thanks to his efforts. But there are also more serious endeavors. You know, many of you probably know the Guardian's development site. But there are also many other forms of engagement, including corporate engagement. So there is a lot of enthusiasm about the possibilities of digital technology for development. And, you know, if you do development and if you do research, you also find that there's actually very little evidence on how social media campaigning, social media engagement is actually changing or is actually facilitating social change. So you often have that sort of example, the anecdotal evidence. There's a women's cooperative in Kenya who are selling their handicrafts on the internet, which is, you know, which is great, and is one form of engagement. But it's kind of, it is what it is. It's sort of, it's an anecdotal form. But at the same time, you also get many poorly implemented projects. You have volunteering project of students who shouldn't be in the country where they are going to, who are not really, you know, who are not really aware of what they are doing in multicultural settings. But you also have, you know, you have celebrities who also don't know what they are doing. I'm not kind of pointing fingers. I let the picture speak for themselves here. But you also have corporate efforts, you know, a lot of, you know, corporate social responsibility, you know, often that are focusing more on the short-term profit-making and sort of basically cementing some of the ways that the business is doing or expanding markets. So you have all forms of different engagement. And among these kind of very exciting and promising stories about political change, cultural change, you also have, and that's kind of what we are more familiar with, you also have the traditional multi-billion dollar aid industry. So as much as we talk about, you know, how celebrities are engaging, or, you know, if we have a PhD project on how George Clooney is influencing US foreign policy making, these are all interesting and valuable aspects, but we shouldn't forget that there still is a large multi-billion dollar development industry, UN organizations, large global NGOs, philanthropical organizations, you know, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and so on. So what we also, what also sort of gets sidelined is that, you know, there is kind of, there's the new, that is new and radical and exciting, uses digital technology, and there's kind of the old. And I think it can often move into kind of the stereotypes where, you know, those sort of young, enthusiastic global citizen, you know, basically view the old development as, you know, there are some UN guys in white Toyota Land Cruisers, you know, basically spending more time on rest and recreation in Gulf states than actually in a refugee camp in Chad or southern Sudan. So, and at the same time, you know, you have some of the other myths, and that obviously includes the academics as well, you know, that we are, you know, sitting in the ivory tower, starting late work days, and we have proof here. We have a couple of our colleagues here from Roskilde. They're all here and up and early. So there is sort of, there are these kind of encounters where different parts of the aid industry and, you know, and development research and the development research industry is also part of that. I don't want to prioritize or sort of, you know, sanctify any of these different partners. But one of the challenges that we then encounter is how can we actually bring together some of this, and how can we actually make sure that we kind of move beyond the stereotypes of what social entrepreneurs think researchers are doing, of what researchers think or not think development practitioners are doing. So that was also one of the starting points for the GoCom project, is to really you know, bring together those different constituencies and look beyond sort of smaller research project, a catchy photo opportunity, or a nice bloggable story. So, for example, in one of my research projects that I completed last year, I, together with a co-author, we looked in how social media, especially tweets, were communicating alongside the United Nations Millennium Development Summit in New York. So we just wanted to get a very kind of feeling. So you have a large traditional conservative policy summit, mostly kind of white men, older white men in suits, talking about the future of the planet. And then you sort of, you have the social media sphere, active, you know, active commentary from this side. And I think that may not be entirely surprising that those two, 3 years weren't really communicating. So there was a lot of sort of social media buzz around it. NGOs and others were critical commentators. But obviously, they couldn't influence the policymaking, the final document that was drafted at the summit. So we know that there are these kind of disjunctures. And going back to our project, we wanted to have a closer look at what we can do also more locally, and what we can do here in the Øresund region, from Eastern Denmark across to our Skåne county in southern Sweden. Because we know that there is already a very vibrant community. I mean, there's UN City, there are many universities, there are many students, national agencies, and obviously you also have a vibrant startup community, both sort of for-profit enterprises, social enterprises, or any kind of hybrid in between. So in this kind of spirit of critical dialogue, we created the GoCom project. And the GoCom project brings together the expertise of the partner universities, the main partner universities, Malmö universities in Sweden and Roskilde in Denmark. And we are building on existing research, on an existing cooperation. So the Ørecomm, you see the logo in the far corner. The Ørecomm Center has been around since 2008. And obviously, we bring to the table a lot of global research in many countries. Co-director Thomas Tufte is here in the audience. He has done extensive research in Latin America. Norbert Wildermuth, professor from Roskilde, he has done extensive research in Africa, just to give you sort of two examples of what we have been doing. So we have built up this global network of partners and partnerships with UN organizations and universities. But we also wanted to focus more closely on the Øresund region. And the GoCom initiative will focus on bringing together that kind of global expertise and team it up with the local Danish and Swedish development initiative. So to make sure that there is knowledge sharing, but also that there is a way, kind of, as I said in the previous slide, kind of an incubator type of space where we can work on sort of overcoming some of those stereotypes we may have, but more importantly, focus on the common goals that we are having in terms of social change, in terms of international development, and how we can use innovative approaches to research, innovative approaches to entrepreneurship, or innovative approaches to policymaking, to engage with the various constituents. So these dialogues are supposed to look beyond traditional development cooperation models. And I think that's also a theme for the Social Media Week, that we are really looking into organizations, projects, or individuals who do things differently. And to give you a real life example of what we are thinking in terms of doing things differently with different people, we brought Jakob Svenningsen along today. He is an entrepreneur, and he is a real life example of the type of engagement we have started before in our Ørecomm dialogue and at a startup event recently. Jakob is doing what sort of more traditional sources would call development very differently, and he will tell us a little bit more about his approach.
Thank you. Okay, maybe that's too loud, actually. My name is Jakob Vahr Svenningsen. I grew up in Denmark. I grew up in Western Jutland. I do not have an education. I dropped out of school twice, and then I ran away. I ran off to Tuscany to build golf courses and play golf and teach tourists how to drink beer and stuff. And somewhere along my life, I picked up a lesson, which was that I do things my own way, and I'm going to keep doing it. But I'm very distinguished to be part of this partnership now, because I need people's advice. and that's why I'm here. And I'm happy to see I have old business partners and new business partners in here in the house. I'm an entrepreneur, and this means that I build businesses. I didn't do that up until 4 years ago, and I'm going to tell you the story about why I started doing so. And I'm also going to tell you about social media and how I use it, how people find me, and how maybe everyone in this room that I'm related to somehow, except for my neighbor who's sitting in the back row as well, found me. So how many of you are here because of development in developing countries? And how many? Yep, there's one. There's a lot.
Good.
And how many are here simply because you want to know about social media and how it's used? Okay, less. That's interesting. I'm a technologist. I love IT. And this is connectivity. Now, in Western Europe, we would dig in all of our fiber optics in the ground. But you can't do that in Africa. So all of the fiber optics are landing in the large capital areas through undersea cables. And even though they're putting in a lot, it's never going to be enough for Africa to have the same connectivity as here. So I'm going to show you how internet is used in Africa, but also how they communicate to us. I'm going to show you a video made by Zach. He's a farmer in East Africa, in Kenya. I've been up until 3 this morning because I had to change my whole presentation. Because yesterday morning, Mikael wrote me, he's in Sierra Leone today. He left yesterday. He works with IBIS, which is one of the 5 big NGOs in Denmark, and they're very activistic, and they're going there to study how people are being exploited in diamond mines and all these kind of things. My approach is a little different. I don't try to provoke people. I try to work with them and doing business with them. But I had to change this because, first I'm going to show you Zach's video.
Not long ago, I planted a crop of potatoes. Then suddenly they started dying one after the other. Checked out the books and they didn't tell me much. So I went and I did the search. Potato diseases. One of the websites told me that ants could be the problem. It said sprinkle wood ash over the plants. Then after a few days, the ants disappeared. I got excited about the internet. I have this friend who really would like to expand his business. So I went with him to the cyber cafe and we checked out several sites. When I met him next, he was going to put a windmill at a local school. I felt proud because something that wasn't there before was suddenly there. I realized that not everybody can be able to access what I was able to access. I thought that I need to have an internet that my grandmother can use. And so I thought about a notice board, a simple wooden notice board. When I get information on my phone, I'm able to post the information on the notice board. So it's basically like a computer. I use the internet to help people. I think I'm searching for a better life for me and my neighbors. So many people have access to information, but there's no follow-up to that. I think a follow-up to that is our knowledge. When people have the knowledge, they can find solutions without having to be helped out. Information is powerful. But it is how we use it that will define us.
You saw Google in the end, right? That's very good product placement. See, this is another way Lena could begin to decipher the articulation and figure out what's wrong and what's good and what's not. This is Google's way of presenting a farmer that they found somewhere. Well, Michael wrote me without knowing that... Oh, sorry. This is how we all use the internet. What happened? Okay, so here you go. He's got 3 million likes or 3 million views on YouTube for this one video. And a lot of people have uploaded it, so maybe it's even 5 million views. And I suppose you could multiply that by 10. of how many people who watched it on Facebook without actually entering YouTube. So 50 million people is my guesstimate. Most of them, I would say 49 million people watched it in this part of the world, and maybe if we're lucky, 1 million people in Africa. But I don't think that's possible. I don't see why they should watch this. This is how we use the internet in our part of the world. This is me in Copenhagen, and this is my global network. At this point in time, I have about 1,000 friends on Facebook, maybe 800. Now I'm up to 1,600 because I do a lot of these events, and I'm going to get 10 or 20 people from here today just by people coming up asking me, hey, can I help you? Can we do something together? Whatever. That's being an entrepreneur, and that's what I do every day. So the funny thing was that, and this is the reason why I had to change my whole presentation, was that I actually knew Zach before yesterday. I added him on Facebook in November 2012. And I had no idea. That was really weird to me. And I started looking at it. Was this really Zach? Yes, there he is with his potato plant. And this is our correspondence from November. And I explained him, hi, Zach, I added you because of your activity in the group by Paul Pollack. And Paul Pollack is a guy who does design innovation for what he calls the other 90%, which means the 90% of the world that use products that we don't. So all of the products in the world and all of the consumer products are built and designed for the top 10%, not for the bottom 90%. And he's one of the gurus within design innovation. And today we're at this Danish Design Center, and this is kind of key for them also to understand that when you deliver a product to a developing country, as it's called in development terms, it's not about getting the product to the consumer. It's about getting it the last mile, we call it, the last half mile, the last 500 meters is that impossible travel distance to the highway when you're in the bush of Africa. So you can get your products anywhere but in the rural areas. Now, the reason why I asked Zach about something was, and I imagine him right now, I never thought about this before, but it just occurred to me now, he must be sitting in that same place we saw him on, writing on Google, potato diseases. That must be where he's responding me. So I'm explaining him what I'm doing. I'm building a business and I'm doing some research in Gambia. This is what, 10 months after Felicity came up with a name for our business, it's called eGro, and we do e-learning in agriculture. So he's telling me about a story about his grandmother and how she taught him things about agriculture. And then he says, please check out this link because there's some ancient American Indian technology that he stumbled upon that he's going to be using Kenya Go Green and Save Money, how biochar will help Kenya. So this is one of the technologies that we use in our modern agriculture, which is not based on big machines, but on local people doing stuff. And then I wrote him this message this morning just because it might have been fun to him, for him to know that we're doing this today. So I actually want to show you this one first, and then I'll go back. There's this guy in business called Seth Godin. I don't know how many of you are business developers or educated at CBS, but he's one of the gurus of modern communication. And he's talking about tribes occurring on the internet, in the cloud, people gathering in small groups. You have Linux that came out as a small community and started building open source. But now we're using social media, now we're using the internet to cluster in small villages on the global community, on the internet. And one of them was this one. Now it has 6,000 members. I joined about 2 years ago. And it's a group where African people are using social media to gather in a tribe and share basically most of what they're sharing are exam papers on how to pass their scores in university. But now there's 6,000 members, and it's growing exponentially at the moment. So every time you check in, there's 400 new people. And that's how we develop. Now, another business term and business theory is that the internet is causing some sort of distortion to the existing studies of of development, as well as in any part of the world. This is what's called disruptive innovation. Basically, it means that the market is demanding new innovations, and you sustain a production. But at some point in time, a new product shows up that just blows off the market and creates a completely new market. That could be the iPod, the iPhone. The next thing might be this watch where you can whatever. And every time something like that happens, new technology begins to disrupt the picture. So I'm thinking, what's the future of communication for development, and how will the impact happen? And I don't need really have the answer for that. And we're going to be studying it together for a long time, and I'm going to be testing stuff and coming back and whatnot. So this is what happened last night, so to speak, at 1 o'clock in the morning, and I had to stay up. And that was my first story. My second story is actually more about me and what I do on a regular basis and why I'm here. I'm not only a technology geek and now a business geek, I'm also a geek of nature. I'm not a freak of nature, but a geek of nature. What I do is I study plants, and I study ecosystems, and I understand them, and I know how they interact. And now I also know how to design them. So basically what I do in my everyday life is I design ecosystems. So I try to imagine that you're building a rainforest. There's a huge diversity. Maybe there's like 1,000 different species of plants, animals, insects, nematodes, parts of the animal kingdom that you know, we can't see unless putting it under a microscope. And all of them are interacting together. There's bacteria and there's fungi. Now, what I do is I identify all of these different species and I put them together. I mix them in the right way so that every plant in that rainforest is something we can use for timber, for food supplements, for medicine, all of these different things. And I didn't know that this was possible until 5 years ago. And I know Tobias is going to hate this picture, because in the science of development study, never get caught on camera with African children around you, because it's just such a bad image. But here I am. I'm studying the grass. I'm not hugging people. I'm hugging the ground. And the reason why I'm doing it is for the exact same reason of this picture, which is I need to understand what's going on down there. So about a week after having been in Africa for the first time, this is West Africa, this is Gambia, on the very tip of West Africa. I go in the bush. It's not the bush, it's like the backyard in what's called the Kombo area. So this is where people don't have electricity unless you live on the front row, which means right close to the highway. Not the highway, but like the asphalt road. So the first row will have electricity, maybe some parts of the second. But I go to some of the houses in the back. I go in the backyard. There's an abandoned area. And I go in that area, and I start finding species of plants that I recognize. And I'm like, this is pea. This is a pea. I can get this on a can at home. And I go like, okay, I can eat that. And maybe I shouldn't have done that, but at least it was interesting to find food in Africa that was just in the wild. And then I started asking people, so do you eat this? And they're like, no, we didn't know we could eat that. I'm like, wow, I know something they don't. How's that possible? I know something about nature and grass that, I mean, this is from my youth. This is just part of my culture. So the next thing that happens is that this guy picks up a bucket and a pose, a bag from Bilke that I happened to bring there. And then we start collecting seeds, dried up seeds, because we want to plant them. Because the pea is part of a family of plants that are called nitrogen fixers. What they do is they take oxygen from the air in their roots. They have symbiotic relations with bacteria. And in small nodules, which are like little bulbs sitting on the roots of the of the peas, the bacteria use the oxygen and they eat part of the organic material in the soil, and what comes out is actually fertilizer. It's nitrogen. So the pea has this function that you can put the pea plant next to the maize, and then the maize will have its own fertilizer without having to bring in petrochemicals. So I explain all of these things to him, and he's like amazed, and he says, you want to go to my village and see what's there? And I go, yeah, sure. And we travel across the river a couple of days away, and he starts teaching me that what he knows, and he's a medicine man. And I'm like, that's interesting. But he was interested in nature since he was a child, and his old father, he's like 83 years old, and he was 21 at this time. And when he left his village when he was 18, and he came to live in the Congo. But he remembers everything. So he's walking with the baobab seed and some sort of rose-like plant that he says can cure some disease, and I don't know what it is. And again, I'm caught in a bad, bad dress here. It's, I don't know what, but this is, okay, this was 7-8 years ago, so I'm fine. But I started studying the plants, and he introduces me to his old father, who taught him everything about medicine and plants. This is his mother and his father, and these are peanuts. Ah, you can't see the peanuts, that doesn't matter. But he's holding a chicken, and that chicken was donated by his father to me. So the young children in the village, they caught the chicken, and you know, the one that caught the chicken got very famous. And then they tied the legs together, and we took the live chicken all the way back to the Congo, back to the capital of Gambia in Banjul. And yeah, we set it free, but that doesn't, you know, I didn't like to eat wild chicken. I felt I was like an animal protector. I wanted it to live. And he called me up 2 months later and said, man, the chicken is dead. I'm sorry, man. And it was really funny. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to go there. This is in 2008. 2 years later, I go back. I am in between, I've quit my job because I want to stop studying grass and start studying real plants that can actually grow food for people. And this is the way you do it. You have like a microclimate of different species, and you have a nursery, and you propagate your seed, and then you start planting them out into a designed rainforest, an ecosystem. This is called permanent agriculture. And you can turn desert into jungle as long as it rains once every year if you use this system. It's won awards. It's won an alternative Nobel Prize in 1983, this whole technology or approach to agriculture. But I realized that I couldn't extend this very far. I could only save one village. So I figured I'll start an NGO, and then I'll teach people on like cartoons and video, and I'll build an IT school, and I'll do all these different things. And then after having been there in 2010, I meet this guy in the main street of Guildford in England, because I'm meeting with an NGO. And he tells me about a system where you can build internet from tomato cans and coffee cans. And I'm like, what the fuck is that? And apparently this is one of these open source technologies that it's called an open mesh network. And it works by connecting the villages with these tomato cans. This is a tomato can here and a tomato can there. And then they beam wireless signals to each other. So you can have a solar panel, and you can have your modem, and then you can have your wire sticking out of the tomato can. And then you can connect 7-8 villages together. And then you can have one training facility centrally, where you have two houses maybe, and then everyone around it can follow the educations. And this is the education that I would have them do.
When you include poultry, chickens, ducks, or geese, they have to be timed so that they're introduced when the system's large enough that it can handle their physical presence and their scratching and grazing, turning the surface of the soil and the leaf litter over so it decomposes quicker and feeds the system, but also they're manuring the soil, but also they're breaking pest and weed cycles. So they're breaking pest cycles by eating pest larvae. The fruit fly is a classic. The fruit fly stings the fruit on the tree, and the eggs of the fruit fly are in the fallen fruit when it hits the ground. The larvae pupates in the fallen fruit and then crawls out of the fruit and goes into the ground, where it then carries on its development and hatches later on as a fruit fly and goes back and completes the cycle. The chicken breaks that cycle because any fallen fruit with larvae in it are actually eaten by the chicken. So you can break your fruit fly cycle by including chickens into your system once your trees are large enough to fruit.
Remember I said that I wanted to build an NGO, and I was like, these guys have built an NGO, they've built a research institute for this permaculture, and I realized that you can't reach that many people if you only build an NGO, and I think there's 400,000 registered NGOs in the world somehow working with development, and I would just be one of them. So I was like, okay, what do we do? Let's build a business. Let's build a global business, kind of like what we have in Denmark called hedeselskabet. So basically, you teach farmers how to grow crop, and then you sell it on the global market. And that way, you support their economic and financial infrastructure. And they can build a society. So that's what I do every day now, is building a business. And today, I have two twins here from Punjab, that we're building a business plan for venturing into their neighborhood. And then how the hell does that relate to Social Media Week? Well, it does, because people all over the world are building these social medias and websites with communities where you can log in and share information with each other. This is in India called Digital Green, and all the videos, even though this is in English, all the videos, people are interviewing each other in Hindi and producing 25 videos that shows how you can seed, 7 videos of how you can make a system of rice intensification. And if you look at these hits, it's ridiculous. It's 144,000 people have seen these 12 videos. And 36,000 have loved them. And it means that there's an innovation happening. There's a distribution of these technologies in little tribes happening all over the world, spearheaded by the technology of social media and internet. So this whole development is happening on its own terms, and we don't even have to touch it anymore. It just happens. And it kind of leads me away from where I was yesterday, because of all these things I had to go through doing this presentation. But I'm going to stick to doing the business to empower this and to leverage it. But I believe that my conclusion is as on the next slide. But I think we're going to have a debate now, and you're very welcome to ask questions. And I don't know how much time is left from the organizer's side, but what will happen now 12 is...
minutes.
12 minutes.
Yeah.
What will happen now is that Tobias will tell me I'm a fool for having taken those photos. And Lena will begin to say if the first video was made by Google and it was good or bad. And then probably you're going to criticize me for this argument. And I am not an academic, so forget about it being reasonable or not. But actually, we have the ability to find these users in the tribes. That's exactly what happened to me in SAC. And I believe that it's possible to sit down on the internet from this part of the world, share information with a guy who's studying what goes on with American Indians in the Amazon jungle and using their technologies in Kenya. And we can empower them through social media with digital communication for development. And I believe that's what Tobias started by saying, that we're developing the social studies into being online. So would you please, and,
yeah.
And you're welcome to tackle me any way you want. And you're also very welcome to go and answer 4 questions on speaker score. Would you like to criticize me?
No, I'm in this kind of unfortunate position where I have to say, don't hug children in Africa, which obviously is you know, it's kind of more context related. I think there is an issue, and obviously you see the difference in Jakob studying plants and Madonna sitting in a school building. So I think, you know, it was done more purposeful, and I think there's definitely a debate in volunteering that if you want to work in an orphanage in Cambodia, your presence is probably less purposeful and meaningful than Jakob's was. So no, but change the shirt. I think that's probably my.
Yeah.
That's.
Tobias is going to be my advisor in the future on development for studies, as well as other social entrepreneurs. Because I have to admit that I call myself an entrepreneur, but I do this for social benefit. I do this for the good of the planet, so to speak. But what we're building now is the ability, like you said, incubators, incubator-like environments, where we're going to do businesses. And as you can see, if he buttoned up his shirt, this is your shirt now, you would actually be good enough to be a lawyer and an accountant the way you're dressed. This is the most corporate scientist I've ever seen. And
wow. That's
no, honestly.
Maybe we have other questions.
Okay. Is there anybody who has a question? Do we have any questions from the audience here? Anyone who wants to ask something to anyone, Lena, Tobias, or Jakob? Yeah.
Perhaps it's just a suggestion. I found the presentation of the... It's just a thought. The presentation of the what's it called? Denmark's Insamling. Sorry, you're in the way.
Yeah.
Was to me a very standard thing. It was drenching, soaking in emotional porn, and we really have to feel about Africa and so on. It would be interesting to hear what the effect was, apart not measured in the amount of money collected, but what do people actually feel from that kind of advertising campaign. And would it be interesting to think about coupling it up with what actually happens with the money afterwards, which I think Jakob's project here could be an example of. That to me is much more interesting than just seeing the pictures and a lot of Danish artists promoting themselves at the expense of this kind of campaign.
Well, of course, I would also love to know what happens in people's hearts, but I don't really have this is not what my study is about. Of course, I could do audience studies, but this is not what I do. So I would love to be able to answer that question. I think what my research is looking at is how are these things represented. And I originally come from development studies. I've used a lot of time looking at politics in Zimbabwe. And it seems to me that there's a disjuncture between what the NGOs that are participating in Denmark's Insamling are actually doing in the projects, even the projects that are getting supported, but also in their wider work, and then the way that it's being represented in Denmark's Insamling. And I think that is, to me, a larger political problem in terms of what is our democratic debate about what development is.
And I think the reminder is also that, you know, there is a whole kind of underbelly of traditional conservative development work going on. If you think about like Plan International, child sponsorship, and you can dissect it on many, many levels. But Plan International also kind of fundraises about $5 billion a year. So there are enough families in the Western world who are willing and able to buy into that model. You sponsor a child, they send you a letter, they thank you, you know, that they are now completing primary school. And that is a very, very successful business model for Plan and for other NGOs who work on child sponsorship. And if you see some of the World Vision ads around Christmas time, I mean, it's kind of... like, what are the 10 things that are wrong with this ad? You know, and they are all repeating those stereotypes. So I think we also have to be kind of aware that, you know, we would like to see change, and we are more critical, and we have some of the digital tools. But, you know, there is already an established, you know, whether it's Danish television's established routines on producing a show, or whether it's, you know, a large international NGO who has a very successful business model, they know that if they want to reach a 56-year-old woman or like a middle-class family in Denmark, you know, they're using some of the images, and it's very difficult to actually come to that stage where I would say, okay, can we change the representation of, you know, of how you are portraying child sponsorship as a mean to end poverty, which it doesn't.
Yes, and it's related to what you just said. It's, well, in my point of view, there's a trend that when we display, like what we have, the Denmark collection, Denmark's in something, then we use a lot of emotional porn and shows the poor Africa, the poor children, that people are living in, living really, really poorly. And Africa is indeed more developed than the media shows. That actually, is it one a third or half of the African people who's actually middle class? And I'm just
33.
Thank you. And I'm just wondering whether or not you think that Danes can handle reality, that Africa is indeed more developed than we think, and that the development programs we've had throughout the years actually works. We have the World Best News campaign in Denmark, which is quite good in my opinion. But is there some kind of trend that Danes demand to know more than just the poor, hungry African child, so to speak?
Yeah, well, I definitely think that there is a drive. I mean, even just the two people that have commented already are talking about emotional porn, and I wouldn't ever use that word because I think it's much more complex than that. But I think that there is a division going on in development communication towards a greater public today, which is, on the one hand, information about what is going on in development, and then there's PR. And Danmarks Indsamling is squarely PR. It is only meant to be able to generate funding. And so a PR logic steps in, and very professional people that know what generates funding create these campaigns. And of course, one of the things that I wanted to show with this presentation is that there is a feel good, and I don't know, there's a feel good element in the idea that we are all working together, we are all coming together. We see Pia Kersko posing with an immigrant child. We see all this coming together and working in unison. But that's only possible because we work within the PR logic, where the suffering other is one-dimensional and emotionally engaging.
Yeah, and I think there is, I mean, you know, I mean, I also don't want to use, and we're on camera, so I don't use the P word here. But I think there's more an issue about armchair activism, which is, you know, you can help Africa by sending a text message to the Teleton. You can't, you know. It's a feel good. It's feel good, you know. And same, like, you know, you sponsor a child, it makes you feel better. But there are obviously many, many other ways of engaging. You know, if, for example, you know, in other kind of Western culture, I would always say, what is the most kind of valuable good you have, and that's time. So giving money from your bank account to sponsor a child, that's the easy way out. If you would say, do you want to volunteer 3 hours a week in a homeless shelter? Yeah, that's, you know. Buying the magazine from, you know, from the person who's selling it on the street. That's something. But, you know, it's really about, you know, are you making that kind of activism? And social media always has that challenge. I mean, you know, the Kony campaign was a very good example. I mean, Joseph Kony, if he's still alive, he's enjoying his freedom. He's not in jail. He hasn't been killed. And Invisible Children, the organization behind it, now has, you know, many, many problems. With their sort of whole module of fundraising and spending money, which we can't really go into right now. We have to wrap up, Marie?
Yeah, we have to wrap up. We are about to finish here. Maybe one more. If there is anyone, have a short question. Anyone? It's a short question. Yeah. Is that, yeah.
It's more related to the
You have to have a first what you call an initial investment. You have to give them a solar panel, and you have to make sure that the local village chief owns that solar panel so nobody else is going to steal it. You have to put voodoo on it so that they know that they can't take the cables away. There was a presentation the other day. We have some startup workshops going with DTU Photonics about how can we build a better internet in these rural emerging markets. And they have in South Africa something called overnight corrosion. And it means when the cables corrode over in one night, it's not physically possible, but it means they steal all of the cables. It happens in Denmark. And of course, it's not feasible and it's not thinkable in the next 50 years that you're going to have a system unless it's decentralized. There's another thing happening. In Kenya, the national power company, the correspondent to Dong, has now stated that they will no longer put wires in the rural areas. They are simply forgetting about it. They're pulling back into Nairobi and they're only going to provide the consumers in the urban areas, which means there's going to be a higher rural-urban drift, more people moving to the cities because that's where it goes down. So we have to roll the other way. We have to put connectivity in the bush. We have to put solar panels in the bush. But solar panels themselves are not sustainable. They last for 36 months before the batteries are at 50% capacity, and then you don't have electricity in the evening either. So you need to have maintenance. Yeah. But teaching people to build a windmill, I think that's a good idea.
And it goes back, I think, to your earlier point, is maybe about the middle class. I mean, I don't want to, you know, start a fully fledged development lecture here. But I think what is important to keep in mind is also, you know, the inequality between it. So, you know, you have kind of, you know, you have Nairobi, which is, you know, the kind of the modern side of Africa where many things are happening in many other capitals. But then you have the huge inequality between, you know, what is an emerging middle class in Africa and those who are definitely, you know, part of it. And I think that's the same. It's not only an African phenomenon. I mean, it happens in the States, it happens in Europe. That, you know, it's the inequality between those who are rich or middle class and those who have no means to participate is actually growing. And I think that would be an interesting issue rather than looking at to say, well, there's one third. You know, I mean, with numbers, it's always a bit tricky.
Thank you very much. Thanks for your participation. GoCom will host its first workshop the 10th of April. There is an email list in circulation here during the crowd, round in the crowd. There is also some information further down on the table in that corner where you will find a little bit more information about Ørecomm and some contact details. And thanks to you, Jacob, Tobias and Lene, for your lovely presentations here today. Let's give them a hand.
Thank you. Thanks.